you can devise your answers on the second quiz for up to 4 points of extra credit by next Monday at noon. In general, in the assignments, I'm looking for your reasoning more than for the quote-unquote right answers. Please show your work on all questions. The answer by itself is not sufficient. I want to know how you arrived at that particular answer. Indeed, it is possible that a wrong answer that is carefully reasoned will receive a higher grade than a quote-unquote right answer that is poorly reasoned. It is reasoning, the step-by-step procedure, that matters in the grading. Since after all, this is really a course about how to reason about economic problems. Most students did fine on the first question, but please note that in describing absolute advantage and comparative advantage, please provide definitions and numbers. On question number two, students ran into problems. So there are ostensibly two outcomes to analyze. In A, we assume that although the matrix of payoff is available to all players, the response of the rival player is not known. So for example, the booster does not know that the Lady Mark has chosen high prices or low prices. But booster does know the payoff in either case. So let's put that game on the whiteboard to make it easier to understand. The payoff and profits for blue food are shown in the first number in each cell of the matrix. So Lady Mark's strategies are in columns. Those strategies are in the roles. So for example, if Blue chooses high prices and Lady chooses low prices, then the payoff is zero to Blue and three to Lady Mark. This strategy in analyzing these kinds of games is to consider first, what does your rival do to each option? So, for example, if you are representing blue shirt, unless first, your best answer to ladies' high prices and then determine your best answer to ladies' low prices. So I saw, for example, some answers that have combined high prices by lady with low prices by blue, and then low prices by lady with high prices for blue. You will not get anywhere with that kind of reasoning. Instead, break down the problem by considering each option of the rival in turn. So, for example, let us suppose that you represent blue. Consider first that many may be choosing high prices, and that this would do best with such low prices, since 3 is better than 2. Now, to keep track of the results, I recommend that you underline each preferred strategy. In Blackboard, I am not able to underline numbers, so I will instead put the underline sign to the right of the chosen option. Second, suppose that many sources low prices. You have to look at both options because in this scenario, you do not observe what many actually does. So if many chooses low prices, it would be better to choose low prices as well. One is better than zero. So underline that option. Okay. Now, suppose that you are representing Lady Mark and consider your options given the blue dots in this case. If blue chooses a high price, it would be better to choose a low price rather than a high one, since 3 is better than 2. So underline that possibility. And then if blue instead chooses low prices, one is better than 0, so you will choose low prices as well. Now observe that by underlining the answers, you arrive at the position of the game, which is low prices by both blue and lady. In that case, low prices, as your underlining shows, is the best response for both blue shirt and lady mark. Thank you. So that took care of the first component of person number two. Okay, and part B for extra credit. Now assume that each bird can observe what the Bible does and solve the game. So blue sees that Megan Mark chooses high price. What difference does it make? So, let's see, if Benny chooses both choices, then the best response by blue food is both prices. And then it sees that boom searches for prices. So then it responds with both prices as well. In other words, in the same, the fact that you can observe what the Bible does makes no difference whatsoever to the solution. The only difference is that if you can observe what the Bible does, that will simplify your calculations. Otherwise, the solution is exactly the same. Since both prices maximize payoff, profits for each player regardless of what the other player does. The problem here is not uncertainty. Okay, now here's a puzzle for you to try to extra credit right now. Suppose that the two scores built up an agreement to charge high prices. The agreement cannot be enforced. And only the two stores know about it. My question for you is this, but now is the solution to the game. I think that this will take me takes you about 3 minutes to think about, and then people meet from being and answer the person as a class. 3 minutes. Thank you.
Solution is high price and high price, because all two of them get two and two.
So you're saying that the position would be high prices for both players. So okay, let's say that I'm representing blue. I am dishonest. I observe that this up to her agreement and charges high prices. I would do better than charging not high prices but low prices. Three is better than two.
Isn't it irrational? Because lady will after that change the low price and they get the same amount.
Yes, the answer in this case is that even though the two stores sign an agreement saying that they will charge high prices, in fact, they will each charge low prices. The agreement makes no difference to the solution of the problem.
I mean that lady after time also will change the low price, and overall they get less points. Isn't it irrational just stay both of them in high prices?
That's a curiosity about the business dilemma. In fact, the individual choices in the bin do not maximize the common value.
Okay.
Nevertheless, it remains true that given what the other store is doing, it will pay you to charge low prices not to live up to the agreement.
Yeah, probably.
After all, if you do, as the representative for Blue Food, charge a high price, you're giving up 1 million penny of profits. This is a machine. More profit can you charge more prices instead. In other words, it pays both firms to cheat on the agreement, kind of like OPEC. So what can the two stores do to ensure that they both live up to the agreement of high prices? How can the stores make high prices impossible? Well, maybe they will call in somebody to observe the agreement. Maybe they will publicize it to the newspapers. So that if one store does the name on the agreement, they will suffer a loss in the reputation, a possibility.
also by government regulation.
Okay, so the government could enforce the agreement to the structure. That's a very good point. So now we have the rule of law as a solution to the game. Okay, any questions about the problem of potential solutions?
It's okay.
Okay, good, thank you. So I think that is good for 2 points of extra credit to each member of the class, and then another point for Terzan for leading the discussion. Question three observes a similar problem, similar to that in question number two. So again, even though not a country sees what the Bible is doing, but those countries do have the payoff matrix, that lack of observation does not change the payoff, does not change either the solution to the game. So again, the solution is war for both countries, even though that does not maximize the political chaos greatly. And then there were some problems in answering part B of the question, mainly in explaining what a mass equilibrium does. Put that name on the board. Russian options are in the rows, and Ukraine options in the columns. So let's see what we get. If Ukraine pursues peace, Russia will pursue war. So let's undermines that option. And if Ukraine pursues war through a dividend one, Russia will pursue war as well. And now, this is the game from the Ukrainian point of view. If Russia pursues peace, Ukraine is better off. The region war. And if Russia goes to war, war is also the individually optimal strategy for Ukraine. So notice that we have underlined both payoffs in the solution to the game, war and war. Is this net equilibrium? We'll first consider what is the net equilibrium. This is one way, a very general technique for solving games. In fact, you can solve any game that is well structured. So is war and war a net equilibrium? What do you think? For one point of extra credit.
Yes, we have net equilibrium.
Okay. And why do you think that is the case?
I think Neshek Blueberry will be war and war. Because if we take Russian, first of all, in both cases, even Ukraine choose war or peace, he will gain more in situation he choose a war. And we know that Russian will choose war. And Ukraine also knows that he will choose a war. And for this solution, both of them take a war.
Yes, good.
This is Nash equilibrium.
Exactly. Yes, good. So given that Russia pursues war, Ukraine will respond by bringing to war as well. And given that Ukraine will go to war, Russia will respond by bringing to war as well. So this is the definition of net equilibrium. Notice that peace is not a net equilibrium. If Russia pursues peace, Ukraine will face war. the dinner that Ukraine loses war, Russia will be destroyed as well. The socially optimal outcome is not a match equilibrium in this case. Okay, now in the extra credit, I ask you to consider that both nations, each nation, provides an instrument fund to the UN of a $2 billion, I think. Ripple, sorry about that. There's a player who loses war. So how are we going to take into account the extraordinary funds in our game? I believe that Nirvai had the financial on this one.
My answer? May I answer?
Say again.
They both will choose a piece and piece.
No, the chief. What if they don't choose peace?
If it's 2 billion will be equilibrium to two, cut off 2 points.
This is this war, yes. So represent the new game for subtracting 2 points in the case of a player who goes to war. So if Ukraine goes to war, the tail will drop from 5 to 3. And if Russia goes to war, its tail will drop from 5 to 3. So now that we have voted the tail to win the war, peace, the socially optimal strategy, is a solution to the game for both players.
Peace and peace will be nice equilibrium.
It is a nice equilibrium as well. In fact, all dominant solutions are that. Since by definition, in a dominant solution, each player has a winning strategy regardless of what the other player does. So since peace is now a government strategy for Russia, whose borders open Ukraine does, it also involves the special peace that Ukraine has decided to wage peace. So, of course, in reality, nations do not divide the throne of France to the UN. Although the UN Security Council does impose sanctions. If the system can be enforced. Okay, so that takes care of the players, unless you have questions or comments about it. Okay, good. On the middle page, I have put this extra credit assignment on the page for you to install for this coming Friday to 10 points of extra credit. So you can download the game from Moodle.
It will be War and War?
Say again.
A Nash Equilibrium will be a War and War?
Well, I'm not prepared to say.
Nash Equilibrium will be War and War.
Maybe, maybe not.
Yes, because two of them get six. That's obvious, no?
So, I'll let you think about it for extra credit for tomorrow. And then Friday, you can submit to me your solution to the game.
I think it's obvious to both of them take a war.
Maybe. If you think so, you can email me that particular question. And then we've already seen that some games do not have an obvious solution. And there is our basic result so far. By a pure strategy, I mean that it is definite what a player will do, thus it either goes to war or it pursues peace. One option or the other, that's a pure strategy. Then a mixed strategy, there is some possibility that Russia may pursue war and some probability that it will instead pursue peace. In other words, the mixed strategy draws upon both options, but the pure strategy uses only one option, That's the difference. And curiously enough, both Jeff and James have an odd number of solutions, odd number of nasties for India. So in their blessing and pin game, there was one nasty for India. So one point that you can draw upon for this game is that there is either one or three nasty for India. If the two strategies are the solutions, and I will give you there's a point of interest that in fact this game does have two strategy solutions. Okay, so far we have looked at the games that both players are making their decisions at the same time. It is a simultaneous move game. However, in a lot of games like chess, each player is moving in turn. The players do not make the decisions all at once. So this kind of game requires a different method of solution. And the sequential game, we will begin at the end of the game, find the solution there, and then look your way back to the beginning. So here's an example. Apple is thinking about whether to build a factory in China or in Japan. China is more profitable, but Japan can promise, honestly, not to tax Apple. China, on the other hand, will tax Apple. So there is the sequential game from the game tree. Here are the payoffs in terms of profits. That is, the first number is the payoff to Apple, and the second number is the payoff to the country, either China or Japan. So let's begin at the end of the game to predict what will happen. Suppose that Apple goes to China. Now it is China's turn. China now decides whether to tax Apple or not to tax it. Well, four is better than one. So China will tax Apple. And now consider the game from Japan's point of view. If Apple goes to Japan, it will have a payoff of $2 because Japan has convinced Apple that it will not serve a tax in Panama indeed. Under the binding commitment. So, if Apple goes to Japan, it will make $2. If instead it goes to China, it will make $0. Two is better than zero, and so Apple will go to Japan, even though the more profitable site was China, with a total profit of $4. from again in the fruitful day. Begin at the end and then begin your way back to the beginning. You put one point of extra credit. Suppose that China can try to be Tibet to intervene in, not to attack Apple. What is the solution now to the game?
My answer?
Go ahead.
Apple go to the China because 3 is more bigger payoff than 2 in Japan.
But the 2.
By looking at the picture, Apple will gain 3 rather than 2, and he will go to the China.
Yes, so all that China needs to do is to eliminate this possible option. Without that, there are only 2 possible outcomes to the game. Either the thing goes to China, or goes to Japan, and in other case, it doesn't pay a tax. So now this is the optimal solution. If an Apple goes to China, then in fact, it has higher profitability anyway. And I go in now with this very interesting game. Very more and truly American comedians, they're known as the Three Stooges. But the conceit here is that they are in the three-way duel. So in the first round, very more and truly, each have one chance to fire a bullet. And then if they survive, they will receive a second shot. However, what you need to know is that Larry is a very poor shot. He has only a 30% chance of killing his rival. No has 80% and probably never misses. So the question you need to consider overnight, what should they do in this case? Maybe has the first shot, then no, and then Curly. For a 2 points of extra credit.
Third best.
I'm sorry?
Third best for Larry.
Oh, well, this, but in fact, you can solve the game just by assuming that the list of sons is that you just killed. You can take it from there. Any questions about potential games? So in the potential game, consider what happens at the end of the game and then put the day back to the beginning. For most potential games, that will be sufficient.